The next topic we are going to start is the circulation of a vector, and then we will define what is curl of a vector field. So the circulation of a vector, it is defined as the line integral of a vector field over a closed path. So as we had defined the flux of a vector through a surface, so there we drew a surface. Here we had drawn a surface, and then we found the surface integral of the vector field over that particular surface. So the circulation of a vector, it is defined as the line integral. So in place of surface integral, now we are talking about the line integral. So the line integral of the vector field over a closed path, and that closed path is present in the field. So let's say there is some vector field which is present in the space which is shown over here. So we have to define the circulation of a vector, and this is defined over a closed path. So let's consider any closed path in the field. So I have drawn over here a closed path in the field. As we had drawn a surface in the vector field, similarly now we are drawing over here a closed path in the vector field. So on this closed path, so at all the points on the path which we have drawn over here, there will be a certain direction as well as magnitude of the vector field. So we will calculate this term, the line integral of the vector field over this closed path. So let's say we are moving in the anti-clockwise direction in this closed path. So the line integral of the vector field over this closed path, and we are moving in the, let's suppose we are moving in the anti-clockwise direction, so that will give us the circulation of that vector field on this closed path. And this circulation of a vector, it has a direction, it is a vector quantity, and its direction is given by the right hand screw rule. So in the right hand screw rule, what we do is, to find the direction of circulation, we will circulate, or we will curl our fingers of the right hand along the path we have chosen. So now the direction in which we are moving is the anti-clockwise direction. So the fingers of the right hand, they must be curled in the anti-clockwise direction. So the direction of thumb will give you the direction of the circulation for that particular closed path. So as you will change the closed path, and as you will change the direction in which you are moving in the closed path, so the direction as well as the magnitude of the circulation, it will also change. So circulation of a vector, it has a magnitude as well as it has direction, and the magnitude is calculated by this formula, and its direction is found out by the right hand screw rule. So now at a particular point in the space which is present in the vector field, so there is some vector field which is present in space. So let's say this vector field is B vector. So now we are going to define curl of a vector field using the circulation. So in the last articles, we had defined the divergence of a vector field using the flux of that vector field. So we had related the divergence of a vector field with the flux of the vector field through a surface. And here now we are going to relate the curl of a vector field with the circulation of that vector, that is with the line integral of the vector field over a closed path. So this curl of a vector field, it is defined at a particular point in the space, as the divergence of the vector field, it is also defined as at a particular point in the space. So in that case, we had used the limit of volume approaching to zero. So as volume will approach to zero, we will approach to a single point. So in this case also, curl of a vector field, now this will be defined at a point in the space. So for this, the definition of the curl of the vector field, it is given by the line integral of the vector field over a closed path, and this is the circulation. This will be the circulation of the vector. Now at this single point in the space, we can draw any closed loop. Let's say if I draw a closed loop in this direction, then I can get the value of the circulation by considering this closed path. And I can also get another value of circulation by defining the closed path in this direction. So by changing the shape as well as the orientation of the closed path, the circulation of that vector field will change. So now what is the circulation that we are taking in the definition of the curl of vector? So this circulation is the maximum circulation which can be possible. So there will be infinite number of closed paths that you can draw around this single point. Around a single point in the space, we can draw infinite number of closed paths. So we will get infinite number of circulation of that vector. So that will be according to the closed path that we have chosen. So now the circulation that we are taking in the definition of the curl, this circulation will be the maximum circulation from all those infinite number of circulations that we will get. So infinite number of circulations are possible. So the only the maximum value of circulation will be taken in the definition of the curl of vector field. So there will be only a single closed path over which the circulation will be maximum. So only that path will be chosen. So the curl of a vector field, it is defined as the line integral of the vector field over a closed path, or you can say it is the maximum circulation of the vector field which we are taking in the definition of the curl of vector. And this line integral, it is divided by the area, which is denoted by S. So the area which is enclosed by that closed path. So this circulation, it is defined over a particular closed path where the circulation is maximum. So let's say this is the closed path. This is the closed path where the circulation is maximum. So there will be some area which will be enclosed by this closed path. So let's say that area is capital S. So we will define the circulation divided by the area which is enclosed by that particular closed path. And here also we will use the limit of S approaching to 0. That is the area it approaches to 0, because the curl of a vector field, it is defined at a single point in the space. So now we have drawn a closed path and we have got a particular surface area. So for the definition of the curl, we will approach the surface area to 0 so that we will get a single point in the space. So this is the definition of the curl of vector. And now this right hand side expression, it gives us just the magnitude of the curl of vector B. So curl of a vector field, it is a vector quantity, and the direction of the curl of vector field, it is also given by the right hand screw rule. So the direction of the curl of vector field, it will be same as that of the circulation that we have used over here. So circulation of a vector is also a vector quantity, and this points in the direction, in the same direction as that of the area vector. Area vector is always perpendicular to the surface. So this circulation, it points along the area vector. So the curl of the vector field, it will always point along the circulation. The direction of the curl of vector field will be same as that of the circulation of the vector field which we are using over here, and it will be same as that of the area vector. So the definition of curl of B vector, it is the maximum value of circulation, the maximum value of circulation per unit area drawn around a point. It is drawn around a single point in the space when the area enclosed by the closed curve, the area capital S, the enclosed by the closed path, it tends to 0. So it should tend to 0. So this will give us the magnitude of the curl. It will just give us the magnitude of the curl of the vector field at that particular point. So this curl of a vector field, it is a vector quantity. Now we are going to derive the expression of curl of a vector field in terms of Cartesian coordinates. So using this definition of curl of vector field, now we will derive the expression of curl of vector B. So as we had done the expression of the divergence of a vector field in terms of Cartesian coordinates, so similarly we are going to do the expression expression for the curl of vector B in terms of Cartesian coordinates. So let's say there is some vector field which is present in space. So at every point there will be some unique value of magnitude as well as direction. So that is the definition of a vector field. So let's say there is some vector field which is spread in the whole space. First of all, we are going to find the x component of the curl of vector B. So curl of vector B, it is a vector quantity. It will have x component, y component and z component. First of all, we are just going to find the x component of the curl of vector B. Then we will find y component of curl of B. Then we will find z component of curl of vector B. So first of all, we are going to find this x component of curl of B. So x component of curl of B, it will point along the x direction because this is the x component. So it will point along the x direction. So let's say we are going to define the curl of vector B at this point in the space. Now the curl of a vector, it is defined at a single point as we have already said. So let's say we are going to find curl of vector B at this point in the space. So x component of the curl of B, it will point in the x direction, in the plus x direction, because we are going to find the x component. So x component, it always points in the x direction. So this will be the direction of curl of vector B, its x component. Now earlier we had seen that the direction of curl, it is given by the right hand thumb rule, right hand screw rule. That is, you will circulate your fingers around the closed path and the direction of the thumb will give you the direction of the curl. Here what we know is, we know the direction of the curl, which is along x-axis, because we are talking about just the x component of the curl of vector B. So it is pointing along the x-axis, means the thumb of our right hand, it will point along x direction, that is along the right hand side, and the direction of the fingers, it will give you the direction in which we should move in the closed path. So the direction in which our fingers will curl in that case, so that will give us the direction of the closed path in which you are moving. So if you will point your thumb in this direction, so the direction of the fingers, they will curl along this direction. So therefore we have drawn a loop which is a rectangular loop. So you can draw any kind of loop. It can be a circular, it can be a square. So I have drawn over here a rectangular loop whose length and breadth, they are given by delta z and delta y. So now this loop, it will be, the plane of this loop, it will be parallel to the yz plane. So that we have calculated using the right hand thumb rule. So the plane of this loop that we had drawn, this is an imaginary loop. So the plane of this loop, it will be parallel to the yz plane. So this direction AD length, this length, it is parallel to the z axis. So let's suppose this length is equal to delta z because it is parallel to z axis. So the BC length, it will also be equal to delta z. Similarly, the length CD, this length, it is parallel to the y axis. So CD length will be equal to delta y, and therefore AB length will also be equal to delta y. So the area of this loop will be equal to length into breadth, that is delta y into delta z. So the area of this loop will be equal to delta y into delta z. So this is how we draw the diagram. This is how we draw a loop if we want to find the x component of curl of B. So after finding the x component of curl of B, then we will find the y component of curl of B. So in that case, the loop that you will draw will be parallel to the xz plane, because now in that case we will be finding y component of curl of B. So that should point in the upward direction, in this direction, parallel to the y axis. So the loop that you will draw in that case will be parallel to the xz plane. Similarly, you can find the z component of the curl of B. So in that case, the imaginary loop that you will draw will be parallel to the xy plane. So first of all, we are going to find the x component of curl of vector B. So x component of curl of vector B, so we will simply Right over here, use this definition of curl of B. We will simply replace the curl of B magnitude with the x component, and we will replace the area that we have used over here. It will be the x component of the area. So that will be replaced by S, will be replaced by Sx. So over here we have replaced S with S. X is written in the subscript. And the circulation that we will find in this case the circulation, it will be over this imaginary loop that we have found out using the right hand screw rule. So the loop on which we are going to find the circulation will be A, B, C, D. So from A point you will move to B point, then B to C, then C to D, and last D to A. So that will give you the line integral of the vector field over a closed path. So that will be this term. Now this first expression, it will remain as it is. Now we want to evaluate this expression, because we want to find the left hand side, the x component of curl of vector B. So we have to find this circulation. So this closed line integral, it can be divided into open line integrals. So this closed path from A to B, B to C, C to D, D to A, it can be divided into individual open line integrals. So this can be written as an open line integral from A to B plus open line integral from B to C plus open line integral from C to D plus open line integral from B to A. So this inside the integral vector B dot dl vector, this will remain the same. These terms, they will remain the same. Vector B dot dl, vector B dot dl, this will remain the same. So now we want to find is these four integrals. So these four integrals, they will be found out individually. First of all, we will find what is the line integral of the vector B over the length A to B. That is, we are moving from A to B, and we have to find the line integral in this path from A to B. So first line integral of vector B over AB path. Now first of all, what we will find is what is dl vector in this case. When we are moving from A to B, what is the dl vector? So in this case, dl vector, that is, we are moving from A to B, we are changing the y coordinate. So we are moving parallel to the y axis. So we are changing the y coordinate. Z and the x coordinate, they will remain the same when we are moving from A to B. So the length element, small length element, it will be just dy, because we are changing the y coordinate and we are moving from A to B. That is, we are moving along plus y direction. We are moving from A to B, we are moving in the plus y direction. So dl vector in this case will be equal to dy j cap. So this will be the dl vector. And now we are doing the dot product of two vectors over here. So when we are doing the dot product, we know when we are doing A vector dot product with B vector, so that will be simply ax bx plus ay by plus az bz. So this is how we evaluate the dot product. That is, we multiply the x component of both the vectors, plus we multiply the y component of both the vectors, plus we multiply the z component of both the vectors. Over here also we will do the same, but in this case the dl vector, it has only the y component. So the component of b vector that we require is only the y component of vector b, which is important to us, because all the two terms, that is ax bx, az dz, they will be equal to 0, because the dl vector, it has only the y component. X and z component of dl vector, they are equal to 0. So we want to consider only the y component of vector b as well. So let's say at the length ab, along this path, the y component of vector b is given by by. So let's consider the y component of the vector field along the path AB. It is given by by. So this integral, it will be simply equal to by into dy. So this integral we will have by j cap over here and dy j cap. So j cap dot product with j cap, that will just give you equal to 1, and we are doing the integral of just by over the variable y, and we are moving from a to b. So by it will be remaining almost constant when we are moving from a to b. So let's consider this length is so small that by it remains almost constant. So it can be taken out of the integral, and you have to do the integration over dy. So this integration over dy, it is from a to b. So at a, let's consider the length is 0, and when you have moved to b, the total length you have covered is delta y. So the y variable, it changes from 0, the lower limit is 0, and the upper limit will be delta y. So it will be 0 to delta y, and on evaluating this, this will be simply equal to by into delta y. So this is how you evaluate the first integral, and now we are going to evaluate this integral from c to d. We have evaluated the integral from a to b. Now we are evaluating the integral from c to d point. So in this case, when we are moving from c to d, we are moving in the negative y direction. So dl vector in this case, dl vector, this will be equal to minus dy j cap. When we are moving from c to d, we are moving in the minus y direction. So the dl vector in this case, the small length element, will be equal to minus dy j cap. So minus is because we are moving in the negative y direction. And what will be the y component of vector b in this case? Because the component of vector b that we require is only the y component. This is because dl vector, it has only the y component, and we are doing the dot product. So only component of vector b that we require is the y component. So what will be the y component on the length CD? On the length CD, what will be the y component? So at the length AB, we had supposed the y component is by. So as you will move from this point, which is on the length AB, and at this point the y component of the vector field is by. So as you are moving from this point to this point on the length CD, the y component, it will change. So as you are moving from this point to this point, the y component of the vector field, it will change. So at this point the y component is by. So when you will move at this point, the y component will be other than by. So what will be the change? When you are moving from this point to this point, you are moving along the z axis. When you are moving from this point to this point, you are moving parallel to the z axis, means the z variable is changing. So the change in the y component will be given by del by del z, because when you are moving from this point on the length AB to this final point on the length CD, so what, which coordinate is changing? The z coordinate is changing, because you are moving parallel to the z axis. The x component and the y, they are not changing. So only the z component, z is variable when we are moving from this point to this second point. So there will be a change in the y component of vector field, and that change will be given by del by del z into the total length that we have moved. So this gives us the rate of change of y component of b with respect to z, and the total change will be given by the total length we have moved, and this total length is equal to delta z. So the total change in the y component of vector field will be given by del by del z times the total length that we have moved, so it will be delta z. So this will be the change in the y component. So the total y component at this point on the length CD, the total y component of the vector field will be given by by plus the change. So we are considering the change is positive. So the y component of the vector field on the length CD will be given by by plus the change in the y component. So over here, vector b in place of The y component of the vector field, it will be integral from c to d, and this will be equal to minus, will come out of the bracket. So here we have dl vector as minus dy j cap. So when you will put over here and you will put the y component of the vector field, so y component of the vector field is by plus del by by del z into delta z times dy, and minus sign it will come out of the bracket, and j cap dot product with j cap, that will give us equal to 1. So this y component of the vector field, it is supposed to be remaining constant on this CD length. As we are going from C to D, we will suppose that the y component of the vector field, that is this expression given in the square bracket, it will remain almost constant. So this can be taken out of the integral, and the integral will be equal to minus by plus del by by del z times delta z will remain as it is. Then you will do the integral over just dy. So integral over dy will be just equal to delta y, because the total length that we have moved is from zero length to the delta y length. So it will be just times delta y. So this is the expression of the third integral from c to d. Now next we will find the last integral, the fourth integral, which was the line integral of the vector field moving from D to A. So we have found the line integral from A to B, and we have found the line integral from C to D. Now we are going to find the line integral from D to A, and at last we will find the line integral from B to C. So let's find the line integral of the vector field from D to A. So this length, it is equal to delta z, and this overall length, this is equal to delta y, and x is constant in this loop, because this loop, plane of this loop, it is parallel to the yz plane. So let's evaluate this. So when we are moving from D to A, the variable which is changing is the z coordinate. You are moving from D to A, so only the z coordinate is changing, y and x, it will remain constant. So dl vector, this dl vector will be equal to dz. The magnitude of the dl vector will be given by dz, because now we are moving along the z axis. Particularly, we are moving along the minus z axis. As you are moving from D to A, you are moving in the minus z axis direction. So this is the plus z axis direction, and you are moving in the opposite direction from D to A. So dl vector, it will be equal to minus dz k cap. So it is along minus k cap, that is, it is along minus z axis. So dl vector will be given by this form. Now the component of the vector field that we require on the length AD, that is only the z component of the vector field, because in the length element also we have the z component, and we are doing the dot product. So the component of the vector field that we require is just the z component of the vector field. So let's say the z component of the vector field on the length DA, it is given by BZ. So BZ is the component of the length, it is the component of the vector field, z component of the vector field on the length dA. So when you will do the dot product, so this integral, it will be equal to dz times dz, and minus will come out of the integral. So bz times dz, now this minus sign, it has come because of the minus sign in the line integral, in the length element dl vector. So this minus sign is due to dl vector, because we are moving from D to A, we are moving along the minus z axis direction. So bz, it will be, suppose that it is almost constant when we are moving from D to A, so it can be taken out of the integral, and you will be left with minus dz integral of, there will be integral of dz, and we are moving from zero length to the delta z length. So we are covering the lower limit of the length is zero, and the upper limit is delta z, because we have moved the total distance of delta z. So this integral will be just equal to minus bz delta z. So now we are going to find the integral from b to c, the line integral from b to c. So here the dl vector will be equal to just dz k cap, because we are moving from b to c, we are moving in the positive z axis direction, we are moving along the plus z axis. So dl vector will be equal to dz k cap, and here also we will have to find what will be the z component of the vector field, because in the dl vector also we have the z component. So the component that we require to find is only the z component of the vector field on the length bc. So on the length dA, the z component was supposed to be bz. So at this point on this loop, at this point the z component of the vector field is supposed to be bz, and as we are moving along this direction towards the bc length, so at this point what will be the z component? So z component of the vector field will change, obviously it will change as we are moving from this point in the closed loop. So what will be the change in the z component of the vector field? It will be equal to del bz by del y, because as you are moving from this point to this final point, you are moving along the y axis, that is the y coordinate is changing. So the y coordinate will change. So the z component of the vector field, it will change as you are moving along the y axis. So the rate of change of the z component with respect to y variable times the total distance that we have moved. So as you will move from this point to this point, the total distance that we have moved is equal to delta y. So this will be the total change in the z component of the vector field as we will move from AD to BC length. So this will be the total change, and let's consider the change in the z component of the vector field. It is a positive change. So the total z component of the vector field on the length BC, on the length BC, the z component of the vector field, it will be given by bz plus the change that we have calculated, plus del bz by del y into delta y. This will be the change in the z component of the vector field, times will be dz k cap. So there will be integral over dz, and the limit of the dz will be from 0 to delta z. So this will be simply equal to delta z. So this will be the line integral of the vector field on the length moving from b to c. So the total line integral over the closed path from A, B, C, D and then back to A point, that will be given by summation of all the integrals, and summation over here is written, first was the BY delta Y, then was minus of the Y component of the vector field times delta Y, then we have minus BZ delta Z, and the last term is this one. So there is a summation of all the open line integrals that will give you the line integral over the whole closed path. So on simplifying, you will see this term, it will cancel with this term, this bz delta z, it will cancel with the bz delta z. So you will be just left with the two terms, and that will be del bz by del y minus del by del z. So here we have del bz by del y minus del by del z, and outside the bracket you will get delta y into delta z. So this is the delta y into delta z, that is length into breadth. This will give you the x component of the area vector. So area vector over here, it is pointing along the x axis direction. So delta y into delta z, it will be just equal to sx. So delta y into delta z, it can be taken on the left hand side. So it will be equal to 1 divided by area times the closed line integral. It will be just equal to this expression. So as the area, it tends to 0. That is, as the multiplication of these two lengths, it will approach to 0. So this left hand side, so when this area Sx, it will approach to 0. So this left hand side will be nothing but the x component of curl of vector B. So this will be nothing but the x component of the curl of vector B, and this will be equal to this right hand side. So the x component of the curl of vector b, it will be nothing but this expression del b z by del y minus del b y by del z. So in this similar way, in the whole derivation that we have done, in the similar way we will find the y component of curl of b. So to find the y component of curl of b, the loop will be placed parallel to the x z plane, and to find the z component of the vector field, the loop will be placed parallel to the x y plane. So this you can write in a similar fashion, and this will be equal to del b x by del z. The y component of curl of b will be equal to del b x by del z minus del b z by del x, and the z component of curl of b, it will be given by del b y by del x minus del b x by del y. So these are the, this is the x component of curl of b, this is the y component, this is the z component. The curl of a vector field, it can be clubbed, all the x, y and z components, they can be clubbed. So the total, the curl of a vector, the net curl of a vector, it will be equal to x component of curl of b I cap plus y component of curl of b j cap plus z component of curl of b k cap. So this whole expression, it can be written in the form of a determinant. So the first row will carry I cap, j cap, k cap. In the second row will be del by del x, del by del y, del by del z. And the last row will be bx, by, bz. So when you will evaluate this determinant, you will get this previous expression. And this determinant is nothing but the del cross b, as we have done in the first or in the second lecture, that this determinant, it is nothing but del cross b. So del, this is the del operator that we have seen. So this is expression, this determinant is nothing but del cross b. So therefore curl of vector b, it can be evaluated using the formula of del cross b. So this is nothing but curl of vector b. Now what is the physical significance of curl of b? So if you are given a vector field and you find the curl of a vector field using this determinant, so what does that curl of a vector field gives us? So this curl, it will tell us how much a vector field is rotating, or you can say how much a vector field, it swirls around or it rotates. So that is measured by the curl of a vector field. Now the figure which is shown in the first case, in the first case we have drawn a vector field which is given by minus y I cap plus x j cap. So this is the vector field which we have drawn in the first case. So as you can clearly see, there is a swirling nature or a rotating nature in this vector field. So when you will find del cross b in this case using this formula, using this determinant, it will come out to be non-zero. So there will be some finite amount of curl, and this signifies that this vector, it has a rotating nature, and it can also be seen from the diagram. Whereas the second and the third case, the second and the third vector fields that we have drawn, so the second one is the vector field which has a magnitude of 3 at every point and its direction is along the z axis. So its magnitude, that is the length of the vector that is shown over here, it is remaining constant, and the arrows, they are pointing in the z axis direction. So this vector, it does not have a swirling nature or it does not have a rotating nature. And when you will find its curl using the mathematical formula, that is using this determinant, it will come out to be equal to 0. And in the third case, the vector field, it is given by z plus 1 k cap. So its magnitude is given by z plus 1. So as you will increase the z coordinate, the magnitude of the vector will increase. So it can be seen in this diagram also, that as you are moving along the z axis, the length of the vector is increasing. So this signifies the magnitude of the vector is increasing, and the vectors, they are pointing in the z axis direction. But you can also see in this case also, there is no rotating nature of this vector field. So in this case also, when you will find the curl of a vector field using the mathematical formula also, it will come out to be equal to 0. So this vector field, it was seen in the case of divergence. So there is a divergence of the field. When you will find del dot B vector, in this case, when you will find del dot B vector, it will come out to be non-zero. So this is a diverging field, but this field, it does not have a curl. Whereas this field, it neither has curl and it neither has divergence. So when you will find the divergence of this field, that will come out to be equal to zero. So divergence, it signifies that how much a field is diverging from a single point. Whereas curl of a vector field, it defines how much a vector field it swirls around a point.